नमस्ते, आई एम अलका मिश्रा फ्रॉम फाहिश फाउंडेशन। आई वेलकम ऑल ऑफ यू इन द वेरी स्पेशल ओकेजन ऑफ दिस इवेंट नेम लाइफ सूत्रास। टुडे वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस अबाउट इम्पोर्टेंस ऑफ योगा इन डेली लाइफ, बट बिफोर दैट आई वॉन्ट टू शेयर टू वर्ड्स अबाउट आवर फाउंडेशन एंड अबाउट दिस प्रोग्राम। तो ख्वाहिश फाउंडेशन इज एन एनजीओ विद इट्स यूनिक फीचर्स एंड आवर टैगलाइन इज अ मूवमेंट फॉर रिफॉर्मिंग लाइव्स। इट शोज आवर एम एंड वी आर फोकसिंग ऑन एवरी एस्पेक्ट ऑफ लाइफ इन विच related to each and every human being, especially underprivileged. And Life Sutra is the initiative of ख्वाहिश Foundation, in which we have started raising health-related issues so that we can easily find out health tips from different experts. Awareness is the main motive of this program. Through this program, we are trying to develop a health-conscious mind, which can lead us towards holistic approach of healthy lifestyle. It's a great honor for me to introduce and welcome our guest this evening. They are well-known experts in the field of yoga. First guest of this evening is Aparna Shukla. She is joining us from Ireland. Welcome, Aparna.
Namaste.
Aparna is a certified yoga teacher in three different styles: Hatha, Vinyasa, and Mindful Yoga. Aparna was born in India but living in Ireland since 2002, and she is in a unique position to understand Eastern and Western philosophy and mindset. She is also a mindfulness teacher and a medical professional, so that she combines scientific knowledge with ancient wisdom. Aparna is the founder of Shubh Connections. This is a hub of different health-related courses. Now, let me introduce, welcome once again, Aparna. And now let me introduce our next guest. She is Aditi. Hi, Aditi.
Hello, namaste.
Om. Namaste. Aditi is from Kanpur. And Aditi Bharadwaj is a professional yoga trainer and life coach. She is into therapeutical yoga as well as life management. So I welcome to both of you in this today's conversation session. And I think today we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to both of them. And I'm very sure that this conversation is going to be very interesting and informative. So on behalf of all gathered online viewers, I welcome you to start a conversation. But before that, I want to mention a quote from B.K.S. Iyengar. That is, yoga is a light which once lit will never dim. The better you practice, the brighter you flame. Thank you. Namaste. Now you can carry on with your conversation.
Thank you very much, ख्वाहिश Foundation, for giving me this opportunity to connect to my hometown, because that's the place where I was born, and I feel so privileged to be called by people of Kanpur to be connected. And this is purely like local going global. So me, Aditi, Alka Mishra, we are all from Kanpur, and I'm connecting from Ireland. So this is a absolutely brilliant opportunity to talk about a topic that is so close to my heart, yoga. Yoga in daily life. That means yoga for everyone. Yoga does not discriminate, no matter what size of body you are, especially those who think they can do yoga. I'm sure by the end of today's conversation, we will inspire and motivate you enough to take up a yoga class. So with this intention, we are going to start our today's session with a small prayer for the world's well-being. Om sarve bhavantu sukhinah, sarve santu niramayah, sarve bhatrani pashyantu, ma kaschit dukh bhag bhaveta. May all beings be happy. May all beings be free of disease. May all beings can see what is good for them. Om peace, peace, peace. With this intention, we begin today's session. And I welcome everyone who's watching. Please come and say hello and say namaste. And if you would like to mention if you are from Kanpur, we would love to hear from you. And it doesn't matter where you're from. I'm sure there are lots of yoga teachers even and my students in Ireland. If you are watching, please come and say hello. So I'm Aparna Shukla from Shubh Connections, as I have been already introduced by the host, Alka Mishra from Khwahish Foundation. And now I would like to ask Aditi. Aditi is a young yogi with a big path ahead, and it's a journey. When it begins, it just does not stop. So I would like to ask Aditi about her beautiful journey on this beautiful path of yoga.
Hi. So thank you so much, Aparna, for the introduction. Thank you so much. And really, I agree with this. First of all, Om and Namaskar to everyone. I would like to thank Khwahish Foundation for giving me this opportunity. Like, yeah, this feels really great to be work in our hometown and to be a part of such foundations so that we can work for our city, for our born place. And that is a really huge opportunity for us, for three of us combined together to make this happen today. So I'm really very grateful for all of you. And about me, about my journey is that, first of all, I would like to give my introduction. I'm Aditi Bhardwaj. Basically, I'm from Kanpur as well. Yeah, I have been in Bangalore from since past years. But yeah, there's an attachment with this place. And just like that, I have an attachment with yoga also. I have been connected with this practice, with this spirituality since 2016. I was also a teenage, like a spoiled one who is a lazy girl. His mom is shouting on her, please eat this, eat that. I didn't know about a healthy lifestyle. I didn't know that persons having the purpose on your life. Like, there is a purpose. There is not that you need to just take a bone and just die and live a struggling life. No, there is a purpose of life which you need to fulfill, the ultimate goal of life. So accidentally, I got into the yoga university. I graduated from Patanjali University under Swami Ramdev Ji. So I trained there in yoga, and I got to know the importance of yoga in our life. Like, you will never understand the benefit, you will never understand the experience until you will experience it on real purpose. So yeah, I was 39 kg of weight. I was very lean. I was a victim of body shaping, to be very honest. Many people were telling me that you're not eating well, maybe because of that. But yeah, body's natural causes that only. But then I started doing practice yoga. It really brings peace in me. It converted my body into a healthy state. It converted my mind from negativity to positivity. I gained weight. I transformed myself. I'm just glowing with the yoga practice. So yeah, this was my journey, how I connected with the yoga and how I changed myself completely. And now I've been able to make that change are really a permanent part of everyone's life, everyone's practice, everyone's life. I've been able to make a yoga a part of their life. So yeah, the journey was great. I'm really liking it, doing very well. So thank you so much.
Thanks, Aditi. Hello, Pratima ji. I can see. Namaste to you. And thank you so much for joining. And so I would like to talk about my journey into yoga. Because I'm almost double the age you are. So let me talk about my journey. So when I was very young, probably 7-8 year old, the first memory I have is of in Kashmir. That time we were only two sisters. And my dad just woke us up at 4 o'clock in the morning on the yoga mat, and we were told to get into these shapes of cow, cat, dog, whatever. He told us and we did it. And then in Kanpur, actually, till date, my dad goes for an early morning walk at 4 o'clock. So till we were at home, we had no choice. Like, if you are at home, you have to get up at 4 and you have to come with him. So we used to go to a park, and there were his friends who did laughter yoga in the park. So we could participate as well. So yes, my dad is my first yoga teacher. Thank you, Mr. Shivram Bajpayee, his name is. And I'm so grateful to him. He is the one who put me on this path first. And then yoga has been in and out of my life. But the most important time I spent in yoga when I was teaching in a college of nursing in Indore. So in Indore, there was a teacher who used to come and teach students, and teachers could also come and join. So I decided to take part. So for 1.5 years solid, every morning we did yoga. And then I came to Ireland in 2002. So I'm here 18 years now. And since coming to Ireland, yoga was kind of gone from my life for a while. But then I'm involved with Ireland India Council. So I got some opportunities to teach yoga in a school where they were celebrating India Day. So whenever they talk about India Day, they can't imagine India Day without including yoga. So I went and taught yoga. I went and taught yoga in a church. And as if it was a calling for me that you need to come back to yoga. You need to start to live more holistically. You start to live a fuller life. And I moved house from city in Dublin to a little countryside. I mean, when I say little means the village is little, but of course the house is way bigger, because in countryside you can live in a very open nature. Yes. So I literally call my house like an ashram. It is like an ashram. All you can see is beautiful green trees and cows all around. So I love this place. And like you, actually 2016 is when I became deeply connected with yoga. When I felt like, that's it, I've got to teach yoga. And then I started to learn. So with Ramakrishna Mission, Swami Purnananda Ji, he's my yoga guru. And then I also did modern yoga training with Durga Yoga Studio, which is Vinyasa style. So I trained with Paula Mitten, my teacher, for Vinyasa. And my journey continues, and I enjoy teaching yoga. And because I'm also a mindfulness teacher, I just feel, and plus I'm a health professional, I'm a qualified nurse and a midwife. I work for a multinational company as well. And I now started this wellness business where I just want everybody to have a healthy body and healthy mind. And I can't wait to connect more and more people. So hopefully we will succeed in our mission, Aditi, by motivating you. So I would like to ask you, Aditi, how would you like to define yoga? What is your most favorite definition?
My most favorite definition of yoga, actually, it is from Gita, Bhagavad Gita. As we all know, there are lot of contextual yoga of yoga. Okay, in Gita and yoga, I'm so sorry. So according to the Gita, there are a lot of shlokas in that in which they define yoga as a union. Yoga is basically a Sanskrit word which means union of your mind, union of your body and soul all together works in one direction to make that stability of your mind, to make that stability in your body. So this is my perfect definition according to me, that yoga is something that is a feeling of oneness, is the feeling of harmony in your body, is the feeling that unite your mind and body and soul. They work all together. It brings peace on your body, and that really feels awesome when you get that state. So I would just like to tell you that many people have that confusion in their mind that yoga is only about the physical postures. Okay, they will understand that yoga is about doing asanas, about doing pranayamas. Yes, it is, but it is much more than that. And for that understanding, you need to go with the ancient textbooks. You need to go with the you need to go with the deep knowledge so that you'll understand the actual meaning. So today I would like to tell you about few shlokas of yoga according to Bhagavad Gita. Okay, the very first shlok in Bhagavad Gita is Yoga Karmasu Kaushalam. That means the perfect action is the state of stability of yoga. That means perfect actions are the positive actions, and that create a positive aura in your mind so that your mind will be relaxed. When you will perform a proper action, when you will react to a proper thing, when you will not react in a disturbed manner, when you will not be like too much angry on something which doesn't worth your anger, then you will not be too happy. The situation is pleasurable, but you will not be too happy. Okay, you will be in equilibrium state. You will be in a equality of the reaction. That is the state of yoga when your actions are perfect. Because if you perform negative actions, that will affect your mental health also. So yeah. Yoga karma sukaushalam, when your actions are perfect according to the situation. And then the another one, yoga siddha siddha samabhutvam samatvam yoga uchyate. Like we can call it samatvam yoga uchyate. That means the equilibrium state of your mind and body. Then you always be like, if it's a situation of pleasure, you will be happy. But yes. When it would be a situation of, when it would be a negative situation, you'll feel sad. You will be like, I'm so depressed now. I'm feeling so bad. And that is affecting your health somehow, right? We know in yoga, if your mind is not healthy, your body will not be healthy. So for that state, you need to be equilibrium. You need to be stable with your thoughts. You need to be stable with your behavior. You need to be stable with your mind, with your body, with your physical actions, as well as your thoughts, your mental action also. So that stability, that stable state of your behavior, your actions, your mental activity is a state of yoga. And yoga brings that state in your body. When you perform the asanas, when you perform the proper spiritual practice of yoga, you get that state. Because nowadays, Aparna, we all know that we are going through a lot of stress in our lives, right? We all go through the stress. Somehow the person is going through the anxiety attacks, panic attacks, stress, high BP, a lot of mental pressure are there. So what we do, we'll get too much excited when the situation will be too pleasurable, and we'll get too much depressed when the situation will be too negative. We don't know how to control ourselves. We don't know how to be stable with the situation, right? So by doing yoga, it brings that stability in your body. So this is the definitions of yoga according to Bhagavad Gita. This is not only just about physical postures. I would like to tell you all, this is not only just the physical posture. This is much more than that. Yoga is much more than that. It brings peace in your body. It stabilizes your body. It harmonizes your body. And it gives you a lot of pleasure in yourself. It unites you from your inner self. That yes. Your inner beauty, okay, that your surroundings. So this is what yoga is. Okay, there are a lot of more definitions according to Yoga Sutras, many more. But all basic meaning is yoga gives you stability of your mind and of your body. Okay. That's but brilliant. There is another thing which would be very easy for people to understand, that there is just not the definition, there is just not the ancient text, but the eight limbs, which we call the eight ways to attain the ultimate goal of yoga. And I would like to ask Aparna her views on that, the eight limbs of yoga.
Yes, I will, because I love even Patanjali's Yoga Sutra. And as they say, sutra means thread. So each thread leads you to something so huge that you can literally talk about hours for just one sutra. But one of the most favorite Yoga Sutra, I will say, and then I will come to Patanjali's eight limbs that you have asked me. So one of my most favorite sutra is number 4, Vritti Sarupya Mitratra. At other times, when he's not in a state of yoga, the man is identified with the thought waves in the mind. So what he's talking about, something so huge, that when he's not in that unified state that Aditi was talking about, that union of body, mind, and soul. So when the man is not in that state, What is he doing? He's just totally identified with the narratives, the stories that are going in the head, and he starts to believe in them. And that creates chaos in the mind. So to stop that chaos, it is so simple. All you need to do is to just practice yoga. And we, the people of India, we actually know it because that's where it originated thousands of years ago. It's a very ancient wisdom that our ancestors have given, which is showing light in every part of the world. And before I forget, I would like to share this story before embarking on the Patanjali's Eight Limbs. That I remember when I was invited to teach yoga in a primary school because they were celebrating India Day that I mentioned. So that was literally a very small village where the population was very, very small. And it's a Corofin in County Clare in Ireland. And even in that small village, there were two yoga teachers. One was Kriya yoga teacher, the second one was Laughter yoga teacher. And I was so glad to be able to meet them. And being us vegetarian, we had no restaurant in small village where there was vegetarian food served. So what this yoga teacher did, he said, "Don't worry, I will go home and cook for you vegetarian food." And he went home and he cooked vegetarian food for us. So you meet those yogis on the path who have such a big heart. And that's the most beautiful about this journey. So now I will come to this Patanjali's Eight Limbs of Yoga or Eightfold Path. So the first four stages, Yama, Niyama, Asana, and Pranayama. All these four stages are basically designed for the body. So Yama, as the name suggests, they are more like your things not to do. So you shouldn't do them. They are yama. They are your restraints. They are your moral restraints. So there are five yamas. And these five yamas are ahimsa, satya, asteya, brahmacharya, and aparigraha. So aparigraha is just literally non-greed. Means not collecting more than you need to live your life. And that teaches us so many things. I'm not going to go into details because this talk is only for 1 hour. Then the second one is Niyama. Niyama, as it suggests with the name, things to do, things that you should do because they are personal discipline in action. So Niyamas are again five. They are Saucha, Santosha, Tapas, Swadhyaya, Ishwara Pranidhana. And then the third one, which is asanas, as Aditi mentioned in her explanation, that how people sometimes just relate asanas with yoga. That is not it. It is way beyond that. So especially sometime in the Western society, that may happen. And even in India, sometimes people get too carried away by the poses that we make. How perfect we look in some particular posture. And it's not about that. It's not about doing headstands. It's not about doing very, very difficult poses. It's just being comfortable in your own body, in your own mind. So asanas is just the physical postures of Hatha yoga that we practice. And then the fourth limb of yoga by Patanjali is pranayama. Pranayama, I will detail it more when I talk about breathing. But pranayama is, prana is a cosmic energy or a life force energy that we take in through the cosmos, and it is available for everyone. So it's a life force energy. And Patanjali talks about how you can make use of prana for your own well-being. Then the next four stages come to the mind. So the first stage starts as pratyahara. Pratyahara means turning the attention inward, looking in, and you start to withdraw the senses inward. And then dharana. Dharana means concentration of the mind. So remembering that I need to keep coming back, I need to keep coming back, dharana. Then the next one is dhyana. Dhyana is quite popular and people understand because dhyana means meditation. And then the last stage is samadhi. So samadhi is almost like for us normal people, it is probably unattainable stage, we can say. But you may get glimpses of samadhi where you are in perfect union and harmony within you and with the outer world. You have that equanimity, that balance in you. Then you can get some glimpses. So these are the eight limbs of Patanjali. And they are so vast and so beautiful. And I always keep coming back to them because you can easily forget. So you are taught in a yoga teacher training and then they may be lost somewhere in your own practice, but it's beautiful to keep coming back to them. And now after Patanjali's Patanjali's eight limbs of yoga, I would like to ask Aditi because she has been teaching yoga. So I want to know from her, what are the benefits, first of all, that you experienced for yourself? You have already mentioned some of them. And you were so honest because that also comes with the practice of yoga. When you talk about your own shortcomings, when you tell people where I come from, I was not always like this. It's what yoga has done to me. And that's what she already described. So now I would like to ask Aditi that what are the benefits that your clients come back and tell you that I experienced this and it's so beautiful. So what are the health benefits?
Thank you, Aparna. You've really it increased my knowledge by listening eight limbs from you. That was really a great thing. And thank you so much for giving us this knowledge. And about the health benefits, we all know that we experience something and we gain something if we do something with dedication. Okay. First of all, I would like to tell you one thing. If you're not dedicated towards your practice, you will never get the results. You will never experience the benefits in your body. If your mind would not be focused on the practice, if your body would be somewhere else, okay, and you're just performing the asana, you're just sitting on a place and doing the breathing practice, nothing gonna work, nothing gonna give you a single benefit. You will just treat yoga like a gym only. You'll just go, you'll put on weights, you'll be like, okay, I'm muscular now. But yoga is something which starts from your inner self. Okay, your extreme consciousness, that starts from your extreme consciousness and unites you with the supreme consciousness. And for that, dedication is important. As we taught in Ashtanga Yoga only, right? That focus, dhana, dhyan, these are the things that put you to that state, that keep you on that state. So according to me, I used to do, in Patanjali Hospital, we used to give therapy, yoga therapy to the patients. So there was a lot of patients of depression also and stress also. So they got relieved with the yoga asana. But one of my case was there. A person was suffering with a depression, okay? A severe depression. He aged about 51 years only. And he has a sodium level deficiency only, sodium deficiency in his body. And because of that, he just kept that in his mind that he's going to be weak. Now he is weak, his bones gonna weak if he'll sit on the floor. He used to sit on the chair only. He used to sit on the bed only without bending his body because there was a fear in his mind. Okay, there was a fear, not any disorder, not any disease, just the fear in his body was obstructing every movement of his. Everything was restricting every movement of his body. So what happened? I got the patient there and I spoke to him. He told me that, no, ma'am, I can't. I just asked him to sit on floor in Padmasana only, on Sukhasana only. He was like, no, ma'am, I can't sit. It will gonna break my bones. I said, just trust me, if something gonna happen, I'm your doctor. I'll be responsible for everything. Just trust me once. And that is the first step when you need to trust on your practice, right? When you need to trust on your body, when you need to trust on your practice, and you should start. So he trusted me. He trusted me and he just walked a little bit and then sit on the floor with folded legs. And that was a trust that made him lose his fear. That was the first thing I kept. And then I started making him do pranayamas. I started making him do meditation. I started making him do yoga nidra. That is very beneficial for the body when you are in the state of very mental disorders. And he really got cured within 15 days only. He was able to wake up early in the morning and he was going on the walk in front of my eyes. I just realized that yes, yoga has the power to treat the mental disorders as well, not only just making your back healed or making your shoulders healed. No, yoga can make your stress relief too. So that was the experience of my post mill when I got to cure a client because of yoga only, cure a patient. So yoga has a lot of benefits in the body. When you start your practice, like the Aparna told us about Ashtanga yoga, yam and niyam are very positive practices for our body. So yoga somehow also works on our behavior, on our routines, on our physical actions, on our body posture. So yoga helps us improve our body posture because when you perform asanas, that improve your posture. Fine, like continually sitting on a chair and then bending your spine will gonna affect you, right? Will gonna give you something when you'll practice, when you'll be dedicated like 1 hour for your body. That is gonna give you something. So yoga heals you from negativity to positivity. Yoga brings peace in your body when you'll be dedicated. Write down, like hashtag dedicated should be there after every benefit when you will be dedicated towards the practice. So like, yeah, it brings peace on your body. It also stabilizes. It also improves the circulation. It lowers your blood pressure also. It also improves your immunity. It boosts up your immunity. Right? These days, immunity is a very big subject we can call. So yoga helps you in improving your immunity also. And yoga have a lot of yoga. Is good for skin. Yoga is good for mental disorders, all kind of body. It also improves your joints. It also gives you flexibility. There are a lot of benefits of yoga, which we will only experience when we'll get to the mat with the focus and dedication in our mind and we'll perform the activities. So when I was doing yoga, I already told you, like to be very honest, as you told me, I was not been able, when I was like, doing Surya Namaskara only. I didn't aware of the benefit of each and every asana. That 12 asanas are very beneficial for the body. I didn't know that. But when I started doing with concentration, with focus, I got to know that each and every asana has a significant benefit on your body. Like Tadasana improves your circulation. Like Bhujangasana gives very comfort to your spine. And just like Vrikshasana improves the stability on your body, good for your nervous system. So yoga also improves the functioning of your body. It improves the processing, the metabolism of your body. It affects each and every, like physical, mental, spiritual, each and every dimension of health it covers. So we get a lot of benefits from yoga like this only. So when we adapt such routine, when we adapt such practice and we give our dedication towards the practice, we get the benefits as well. And you will definitely feel the benefit on your mind. When you close your eyes, sit back and relax and breathe, you'll get to know that your body is getting the energy. Your body is healing now from the pain. When you exhale, the negative would be out. When you inhale, the positive would be in. So you need to focus on your practice also. So you'll get to know.
Yes.
Now, I really want to know some benefits from you also, Aparna.
Yes. And I'm glad you asked this question because you hear so much on the TV and as you said, until you experience personally, you wouldn't really know. And I can tell you my experience in both occasions when I did my yoga teacher training. So in my first yoga teacher training with my guru in Ramakrishna Mission, actually in Ireland. So when I say in Ramakrishna Mission, I'm talking about Ramakrishna Mission in Ireland. So the first class itself, because I suffered with some neck issues previously, when I was doing the Sarvangasana, I managed to somehow hurt my neck a little bit more. And it could have been scary to keep going back and continuing with the practice. But because I have been practicing from beforehand quite a lot of yoga and mindfulness, that fear factor that you were talking about, that just wasn't there for me. I had no fear and I could trust that you mentioned about trust. I could trust my guru because he is 70 years old and still he could, like, you know, he had that love and compassion for us. And he said that, you know, we are monks. We don't we can't even imagine touching women. But my God says that they are all your own extended limbs, your own arms and legs, so you can still go and assist them. And he always said that there are two benefits that yoga offers that no any other form of exercise will offer. What are those two benefits? One benefit is for your spinal column. So all your 33 vertebrae that are stacked one on top of the other, that forward bending, that backward bending, that twisting on this side, twisting on the other side, that just does not happen with any other exercise. And that's why a lot of athletes, runners, weightlifters, towards the later stage of their life, they come to yoga. Because the way they have injured their bodies, now Aditi said you need to heal your body. So yoga will heal your body. No matter even if you come at 50 years of age, yoga does not discriminate on the basis of age or caste, creed, color, religion, your body size. It welcomes everyone. So that's what he said. One benefit is your spine. Then the second benefit is your gastrointestinal system. So if you leave the vital organs aside, then the most important part that our gastrointestinal plays in keeping our bodies healthy. So gastrointestinal system gets immense benefit by practicing yoga. And again, you've got to do it to feel the benefits, as Aditi kept saying. So just remember niyama. Niyama literally in Hindi, niyam. Niyam means discipline. अगर आप करेंगे नहीं तो कुछ नहीं होगा. केवल टीवी पे देखने से या हमारी बातें सुनने से या क्या बोलते हैं कि स्वामी रामदेव को सुनने से कुछ नहीं होगा. आपको करना पड़ेगा, आपको मैट पे आना पड़ेगा, उस मैट को प्यार करना पड़ेगा, उस मैट पे लेटी हुई अपनी बॉडी को प्यार करना पड़ेगा.
Yeah, you really need to get up. You really need to grab. You like something would be happened then, right? When you be dedicated, no, you'll just get up. Your mat will fall. Just get up and come on me, right? I really need your energy to get up now. So you'll just get up and you'll just go when you'll feel that thing in your body. Only then. If you'll not feel, if you're not dedicated, you will like keep skipping your sessions and then you'll skip the benefits also. This happens. Yes.
And then also one benefit you mentioned, which I would like to elaborate upon. So you said about nervous system. So stress equals sympathetic nervous system. So stress always activates your sympathetic nervous system. And what happens to the body when your sympathetic nervous system is activated? That your blood pressure will go high, your heart will start beating fast, and your body starts to contract and become fearful, and your body starts to feel kind of quite tight, and you feel all the effects in your body. But when you do yoga and when you are connected with your body, when you're connected with your mind, that's when your parasympathetic nervous system is activated. And when your parasympathetic nervous system is activated, then it's just that cooling, calming effect on your mind and your body, and you just feel it. You know, you've got to do it to feel it. For me, the best thing I get out of it is the joy, the glimpse of that bliss that I've heard about in the scriptures. But to experience that constant flow of happiness, for me, that is yoga. You know, that joy in life that comes from practicing yoga. So that is about the health benefits. Now, it is important that we talk about our, for our audience, how they can make their first step. Lot of you who are listening may have probably already practiced yoga sometimes in your life, or maybe you are practicing right now, I don't know. But mainly our message is for those who have never ever practiced yoga, how to take your first step in this direction. And how do you take your first step in this direction? It is extremely important that you find a qualified, registered yoga teacher, because the trust that you're going to place on your yoga teacher. You're literally saying that here is my body, tell me what to do with it. Although your yoga teacher will not take it like that. She will say, this is your body. You have got to mind it. I can only guide you, but I am not responsible or in charge for you. So you've got to find a qualified yoga teacher, book for at least 6 weeks or 8 weeks training. And after that 6 or 8 weeks, you may learn enough to continue at home for your own 10 or 20 minutes practice. Another thing I want to clarify here is that some people have this notion in their mind that they think I must practice for at least 1 hour, otherwise there will be no benefits. But I was actually listening to some research yesterday somewhere, and in that research they were talking about all the benefits, and the practitioners were only practicing for 12 minutes every day. So even if you practice for 10 to 15 minutes every day, still you are going to get the benefits. So this is important that you decide today, what are you going? Now, we are giving you a couple of seconds now. So close your eyes if you are tuned in here. I'm asking you to close your eyes. Bring on the screen of your mind a plan for you, for yoga. What are you going to do? When are you going to do? I can hear some of you are saying it's Corona lockdown. What to do? Yeah, I can hear you, honestly. Okay, so if it is Corona lockdown, Aditi is teaching online classes. I am teaching online classes. If you are interested, I will ask Aditi later on towards the end. She will give her details. We might leave in the message box how to book her classes online. You can go into my Facebook page as well, Shubh Connections. You can book and do online classes with me. Online classes are not the preferable option for beginners, but they're still better than not doing anything and being in a Corona lockdown and getting unhealthier, because it's the immunity boosting time, as Aditi was saying. So there's a lot of emphasis on immunity, and your immunity will only get better if you practice yoga. So now coming to the next part of our discussion is to how to set up a daily practice. Aditi, can you give some guidance to our listeners as how they can set up their daily practice if they have already learned yoga?
Yes, sure. So first of all, you need to be mentally prepared for the practice, okay? If you are really willing to start a practice, just start it down. Don't think too much. Don't take it more time, because how much time you will give it to this now? This is going to be postponed, okay? So, like, you just make a prepare window, make a plan, just start. If you're thinking today, if you're listening to us, if you're getting the point, start from tomorrow as well. Every day is a start. Every minute is a start. Every second is a start. Take that, grab that opportunity and start. So before starting, you should go with some proper peaceful corner of your house, of your home, wherever you are living. Just take a proper place, choose a proper place, proper surrounding. The corner should be good, should be peaceful, where you feel good, where you feel light to do practice. Okay, because that corner gonna be the permanent spot of your practice. Because this happens with us, right? Where we do the practice, where we permanently settle down with the mat, we'll feel like go to that spot only, because I'm very much comfortable in the surrounding. So choose a proper practice space, then set a realistic goal. Okay, set your goals. If you're dedicated towards an asana or a practice or a sequence, like there are many forms, different forms of yoga, there are vinyasa, stanga, beginner, hatha. So set a goal towards the practice, which sequence you want. Okay, get to know about that. If you're like, as a Panna told us, that teacher is really very important, right? A guru, if you're teaching, if you're learning under a guru, ask her about the practice. So set a realistic goal about that first. Like, yes, you're dedicated. Yes, you want the practice. Yes, you want to change yourself. Yes, you want to improve yourself. So set a realistic goal. Then, and yes, one more thing. Don't worry about the equipment, right? We see in the YouTube videos, we see in the Instagram videos, we think that they are doing with the circle, they are doing with the plates, they are doing with the bricks. Those are not necessary. Those are the add-on on our practices, right? We can practice naturally also. Yoga doesn't need any equipment, first of all. Like, it is not necessary to go with the equipment. That don't make it an excuse that I don't have an equipment, so I can't practice yoga. Because if you don't want to practice, you'll find an excuse. So don't need to think about that. You can naturally practice yoga. Start with the mild stretches, then go with the advanced practice. First, make your body that way. First, take small steps, and then you'll get the big step very soon. And then take time to breathe, okay? Like, first settling down at a place, take your mat there, settle yourself, set your goal towards the practice, and then give some time to your practice. Okay, if you're starting, give some time. Don't get harsh on yourself. Don't be too hurry about your practice. That why I'm not able to do the proper Bhujangasana, why my legs are not touching the head, why I'm not able to touch my feet. This happens with us. But don't go for the hurriness. Just go slow. Okay, so take break. And trust your body. Trust your body and lose the fear. Because I believe yoga can be restricted only with the two things from your mind, trust and fear. If you're not trusting your body, you can't do. If you're having the fear of the asana, you'll not do. So you need to drop it down. Okay? And then observe yourself. Observe the minute you're starting, observe the very minute you're ending your session. Okay, observe yourself. That is a really very important point, because the observation will get more deepness in your body. That observation will make you more attached to the practice. Okay, so you need to be in a very focused state of your practice. So if you are really willing to start your practice, take a place, take a mat, close your eyes, as Aparna told us, and just decide that you have to do. Push yourself, push your limit, because this is gonna be a helpful thing for you all, okay? And we only can tell, and you only can listen. But you can perform, and you have to perform if you want the improvement. Else, it's up to you. Like Aparna is telling us that all the athletes and all the sportsmen, they all come at their 52 or 55th to heal their joints, to heal their bones. So if you want to keep your body in that state only, that healthy state only, so go with the practice. Okay, so these are the points upon.
Yes, thank you so much. And I would like to acknowledge here one of the comment, Aslam Mahmood ji, aapka ye jo maine abhi main sabke comment nahi dekh sakti hu, isliye please mujhe maaf kariyega, main sabka naam bhi nahi le paungi, lekin Aslam Mahmood ji aapka jo comment maine dekha ki aap 15 saal se practice kar rahe hain. And you are saying that it's a miracle for human body and soul, and you have been practicing for 15 years. Thank you so much. That's what we love to hear, your feedback. And your feedback may give so many other people, and it will work like a light to show path for others who haven't traveled that path yet. And that's exactly what we are doing here, is sitting and encouraging and asking people. जैसे वो एक गाना है जो हम सुनते हैं, उसमें कहते हैं योग के मार्ग पर हम बुलाते तुम्हें, आओ आओ आओ. सो दैट्स एग्जैक्टली व्हाट वी आर डूइंग हियर. सबको बुला रहे हैं हम योग के मार्ग पर, और असलम महमूद जी ऑलरेडी हमारे साथ चल रहे हैं, उसके लिए मैं उनका तहे दिल से शुक्रिया अदा करना चाहूंगी. और अब हम दूसरा टॉपिक, अदिति, इट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट दैट वी मेंशन अबाउट the special conditions, because those who have been practicing yoga, especially for girls and women, they go through these monthly cycles. And during these monthly cycles, for that limited period of time, for 4 or 5 days, their bodies may not feel like doing yoga. And then if they push their bodies and do a lot of those difficult postures, that's not good for them. So it is, again, if you have a qualified yoga teacher, they will give you guidance. But as a general rule, during menstruation, you should not force your body, but you should just take a gentle approach and a mild approach to your practice. That means avoid doing any inversions, avoid doing any back bends, avoid doing any deep, strong twists, because your body is under the effect of those hormones and body is trying to clear out all that is unnecessary. So acceptance comes with practice of yoga, that you just accept that this is the time when my body is not ready to do anything very hard. And that love for your body, that compassion and kindness and gentle approach to yoga is very, very, very important. Then pregnancy is another time when women's bodies are under huge influence of hormones. And because I'm also a midwife, I can talk whole day about pregnancy, but I'm not going to do that because this is not about that. But during pregnancy, you need a yoga teacher who knows how to deal with a pregnant woman's body. I would say you need a yoga teacher who has done a special training for pregnancy yoga. So do take care if you have never done yoga before and you're planning to take yoga for the first time in pregnancy, then it is much safer not to do it for the first 12 weeks. And now I would like to move on to breathing. So pranayama. Prana, as I already mentioned, prana is a cosmic energy. And it will be injustice to just say pranayama is a breathing exercise, because it is way beyond that. Breathing exercise is done in hospitals and they're taught to patients who have any lung disease. But pranayama is a conscious breathing, and making use of this cosmic energy that is available for everyone. And that deep breathing where breath is traveling through every single cell of your body. It's an act which is really profound. And when you are breathing in and you are breathing out, with each exhalation, when you breathe out, you practice letting go. And when you breathe in and you let the breath in through your body consciously, you practice acceptance. So that practice of acceptance, that practice of letting go, is very deep practice. And why we always teach about breathing in through the nose and out through the nose? Because especially here in Ireland, a lot of women do pregnancy classes where they learn about antenatal, and they are taught to breathe in and out through the, like, in through the nose and out through the mouth. But in yoga, we always do in and out through the nose, except in Shavasana, where you can breathe out through your mouth. So it is, again, we don't have a lot of time to talk about pranayama, but a lot of you have heard about Kapalbhati. A lot of you have heard about Anulom Vilom Pranayama. And now I would like to ask Aditi about asana sequencing, because when you get onto your mat, the understanding of your human body and how to lead from one step to the next for your whole yoga practice, even if it is for 10 minutes, but those 10 minutes have to be planned 10 steps, 10 minutes on the mat. So Aditi will give us a quick guidance on a sequencing of asanas.
Thank you, Aparna. So yoga sequence is a really very important thing, okay? If you're doing a yoga practice, you just can't go, like, you just did Tadasana and then you just lie down on your stomach and you did Bhujangasana, okay? Because there are sequences which are made to just like to process your body that way, okay? Because that covers all the levels, that covers all the layers of your body. So we should go step by step. So there are the sequences of asanas which I would like to tell you. If you are starting your practice, you should first of all start with the breathing, okay? Calm your mind, relax your body completely, and then initiate your practice then. Okay, because yoga sequences are designed for teachers, for students to cover all the asanas according with the body, according with the body movements. Okay, so first we'll start with the breathing, then we'll go with the mild stretching. We should start our asanas with the standing posture first, according to me. And these are good for the body because you can push. If if you are doing the cardio before the practice, if you are doing a lot of balancing asana, if you are doing a lot of various kind of asanas are there, if you're performing that, go with the standing asana first. Then move your body from standing asana to sitting asana. Okay, like you did Tadasana, Vrikshasana, and then just sit on your mat and go for the sitting postures like Paschimottanasana, Vakrasana, butterfly pose, like a lot of sitting asanas. And then from sitting asanas, move your body from sitting to prone asanas. Prone means to your stomach. The asanas which you perform on your stomach, like Bhujangasana, Sarpasana, Dhanurasana. So these are the asanas which we perform on our stomach. So after standing, then sitting, then prone, and then we should go with the supine posture, okay, which we do on our back. So just turn on your left and lie down on your back and start all the asanas which you have to perform through your spine. And then from there, you just perform the asanas and get up from turning to left and sit on your mat and initiate the pranayama practice. So these should be the sequences. These are the sequences which are beneficial for your body. This will not affect any of the movement. Okay, these will go align wise. So that will be very beneficial for your body as well. You will not get too much tension on your muscles if you will follow the sequence, if you will follow the proper sequence. So yes, Aparna, these are the sequence which one should follow before initiating the practice.
Thank you so much, Aditi. And now we are coming to conclude our conversation on yoga. And I would like to end with this. This is a book of Upanishad. And from Upanishad, this particular shloka comes from Katha Upanishad. And it says, Indriyebhya parahartha arthebhyascham param mana manasastu para buddhir buddhir atma mahan para mahata paramavetta mavettatta purusha para purushatra param kichitsa kashta sa para gati. Beyond the senses is the mind. Beyond the mind is the intellect. Higher than the intellect is the great self, which we called Atma. Higher than the great self is the unmanifest. Beyond the unmanifest is the person, all-pervading and imperceptible. मैं आप लोगों के लिए हिंदी में भी ये कहना चाहूंगी, इंद्रियों से अधिक महत्वपूर्ण सूक्ष्म मस्तिष्क है, मस्तिष्क से अधिक निश्चयात्मक बुद्धि और बुद्धि से अधिक महान आत्मा है, अव्यक्त प्रकृति से अधिक अत्यंत सूक्ष्म परमात्मा है। अतः वही आधारों का आधार होने के कारण इंद्रियों की शक्ति अंतःकरण की ओर झुका के देखने के योग्य है। तो सारी जब परतें हट जाती हैं तब हम अपने आप को मिल पाते हैं, और वो जो एक मिलन होता है वो अद्भुत है। तो अगर इफ यू आर रेडी फॉर दैट यूनियन टू योरसेल्फ, then we really invite you on this path of yoga. And if Aditi would like to say some last few words.
Yes, sure. I would like to tell you all that, as you mentioned above about yoga sutras, so the very first yoga sutra, you remember, Atha Yoga Anushasana, from where we start. So seriously, if you want to start the practice and you're really liking, like the person who just told us that he is connected from 15 years with us with the yoga practice. So yes, discipline is very necessary. Atha Yoga Anushasana means bringing discipline to your mind and body. That movement creates a powerful energy field. For the first time, we need our true self. Okay, we get to know our true self, and that is really very important for yoga. So I really want you all to start practicing yoga. It would be painful. It would be really very difficult at first. But when you get it, when you will give it some time, when you will be attracted towards the practice, towards the benefits, when you will be attached to the practice, you will definitely gonna love this. Because we both, and just like both of us, there are a lot of trainers out there, a lot of yogi, yoginis are out there who practice yoga. And they got the benefits in their life, they changed their life. And we really want to that change in everyone.
Yes, thank you, Aditi, and I really appreciate your calling for everyone on this path of yoga. Namaste. Thank you everyone for joining.